यू म्यूटेड, यू म्यूटेड रुचा।
यस मैम, नाउ एम आई ऑडिबल? ओके,
यस यस
रुचा, यू विल जस्ट नीड टू
लेट
स्पीक
मी
अ
नो
बिट
व्हेन टू,
लाउडर।
सॉरी,
यू विल जस्ट नीड टू बी स्लाइटली लाउडर।
ओके
या दिस इज बेटर।
ओके ओके, यू लेट मी नो व्हेन व्हेन टू स्टार्ट।
राहुल सर विल टेल यू, ही विल गिव द क्लू, वंस ही
ओके
टेल्स यू कैन टेक ओवर।
गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीबडी फ्रॉम फिजियो टीवी, वी आर लाइव नाउ। आई एम हैंडिंग ओवर दिस सेशन टू डॉक्टर रुचा।
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Very good afternoon to all Physio TV viewers. I, Dr. Rucha Rayas, Assistant Professor from Sancheti College of Physiotherapy, Pune, welcome you all to today's webinar on Exercise as a Medicine, What Physiotherapists Need to Know, by our renowned speaker, Dr. Arun Maya, Professor and Dean of Manipal College of Health Professions, Manipal Academy, Manipal University. This webinar is brought to you by Physio TV, for which we are grateful to the driving force of our institute, our founder president, Dr. K.H. Sancheti sir, our ever inspiring chairman, Dr. Parag Sancheti sir, our dynamic executive director, Mrs. Manisha Sanghvi ma'am, and our principal, Dr. Vivek Kulkarni sir, for providing us with this platform. Before we begin with the session, I would like to introduce our panelists for the day. Today, we have with us our first panelist, Dr. Jayamala Shetye, ma'am, Associate Professor, PT School and Center, State GS Medical College and KM Hospital, Mumbai. She is a famous fellow, batch of 2016, Faculty for Medical Education Technology and Research Methodology Workshop under MUHS. She is UG from GSMC and PG in Cardiorespiratory from Sion Hospital, Mumbai. She has a teaching experience in cardiopulmonary physiotherapy of 29 years. Ma'am is also a PG and PhD guide at the same institute. She has a clinical experience in medical intensive care unit, cardiopulmonary rehabilitation and fitness. It is a pleasure to have you with us, ma'am. Our second panelist for today is Dr. Razia Nagarwala, ma'am, professor and head of cardiorespiratory physiotherapy department at Sancheti College of Physiotherapy, Pune. Ma'am is UG from State GS Medical College and KM Hospital, PG Cardiorespiratory from Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Sciences. Her special interest lies in exercise physiology and intensive care physiotherapy. Total experience of more than 40 years, and ma'am has been teaching at Sancheti since the past 25. Happy to have you with us today. Our third panelist for today is Dr. Rajni Pagare, Professor, Deccan Education Society's Brijlal Jindal College of Physiotherapy, Pune. Ma'am is UG and PG Cardiorespiratory Physiotherapy from Sion Hospital, Mumbai. She has 22 years of experience in this field with 14 years of teaching experience. Clinical experience mainly in intensive care physiotherapy and cardiac rehabilitation. She has several paper publications to her credit. We are pleased to have you here with us today. I welcome all panelists once again. I request the viewers to kindly note that your queries will be addressed at the end of today's session. I now request Dr. Jayamala Shetye, ma'am, to kindly introduce our speaker for today. I hand over the session to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Rucha, for the introduction. I would like to congratulate Physio TV and Sancheti Institute for starting this particular endeavor, where you're getting all the junior seniors are getting to get acquainted with senior people, faculty from our profession, and to share their wisdom with us. So today we have eminent speaker, Dr. Arun Maya. He is a professor and dean at Manipal College of Health Profession, Chief Center for Diabetic Foot Care and Research, Maya University, Manipal. Dr. Arun Maya is PhD in the field of diabetic foot and specialized in rehabilitation. He is the recipient of Dr. T.M.A. Pai Chair in Exercise Science and Health Promotion. Dr. Maya is the president of Indian Podiatry Association, Karnataka Chapter, India, and is the membership director of World Association for Photobiomodulation Therapy, formerly known as the World Association for Laser Therapy. He is on the expert advisory group of Biomedical Device and Technology Development Program, Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. Dr. Maiya has published more than 150 scientific publications in both national and international journals and received more than 10 research grants from both national and international funding agencies. Dr. Maiya completed Fogarty International Fellowship in University of Alabama, USA, Laser Fellowship at France and Podiatry Certification from UK and Finland. Dr. Maiya has already supervised 14 PhD scholars and 6 PhD scholars are pursuing PhD under his supervision. I hand over to Dr. Maiya for his pearls of wisdom. Welcome, Dr. Maiya.
Thank you, madam. And I congratulate the Physio TV led by Dr. Apoor and the entire team for an excellent initiatives of spreading the academic and research knowledge of physiotherapy to all our physiotherapy community, not just restricting only to the faculty members and all. I think this will be reaching to all our undergraduates, postgraduate, interns, research scholars, and all the faculty members. And I think this is the one good important platform for strengthening our academic and the research or the recent advances in the field of physiotherapy. I would like to thank the organizing team for inviting me to deliver a session. And also, I thank all our panel of experts for an introduction as well as also sharing their rich experience during this discussion. Today's topic will be on exercise as medicine, prescribing exercise in clinical practice. I hope the slide is visible to all of you. Is this slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay, madam. Thank you. Exercise as medicine, prescribing exercise in clinical practice. So today's outline of presentation is exercise as medicine in health and disease, screening for physical activity and the exercise, component of the physical activity promotion and the exercise prescription, the summary. First of all, why do we need to call exercise as medicine? Exercise, if you look at in the current or the, you can say the, in the routine clinical practice, normally we just inform or advise our client. They may be healthy or they may be having any specific pathology. Normally, they advise them to go for some exercise. Examples like once they develop hypertension, obesity, or when there is a weight gain, normally most of the time the other health professionals, maybe physicians or other health professionals, everyone say you go for exercise. But is it a prescription? So therefore, the exercise have not gained much importance in the clinical practice because it is not prescribed according to the individual need. Most of the time, I think all our senior colleagues endorse my statement. Sometimes the patient says, I have visited so and so, or I've been suffering from hypertension or diabetes or other things. I've been asked to do the exercise. 2 or 3 days I did the exercise and then I started developing pain. I stopped the exercise. This is the routinely they report to us. The reason is it is not prescribed as per their need. So always I say exercise is an important component of the physiotherapy practice. We are called exercise specialist. So it is our responsibility to prescribe the exercise as medicine and most importantly, creating an awareness among the other health professionals, public, about the importance of exercise. That is not given due importance because the other components are becoming more popular, so that exercise have not gained much importance. Now, if you look at the recent statistics, I can say from 2010 onwards, the people are gaining a lot of awareness about the exercise. So it is the time that we need to sensitize, we need to educate the people, and it needs to be prescribed. Why we call it medicine? Because any medicine have a prescription. So therefore, the exercise needs to be prescribed like a medicine. You need to have a proper dose. You need to have the frequency. You need to have the type or the duration, progression. Everything needs to be properly planned. Before that planning, a comprehensive assessment of an individual is very, very important. One example I will give you, the metabolic syndrome. It is most very common, prevalent in Indian population, especially that is gaining an increase in the prevalence even in the younger population. It's having a combination of, since it's a syndrome, combination of multiple pathologies. So when we are targeting such people, you need to look for their musculoskeletal health. You need to look for their other balance related issue. You need to look for their strength, flexibility, everything. Then only we need to prescribe. Either we need to decide one, whether to go for an exercise prescription or whether we need to go for a physical activity promotion. So therefore, the screening is very, very important. And based on your evaluation, what component needs to be selected? I need to go for a physical activity promotion or whether I need to go for an exercise prescription. For that, it is important for us to understand how an evaluation process needs to be completed before we go for the prescription or the promotion component. Why this is gaining important is, all of us know the lifestyle disease, or most commonly we call non-communicable disease, is a major challenge in the clinical practice. Especially in India, it is increasing very rapidly. So there is a need for prevention, need for early screening or early management, and also need to focus on a comprehensive care of these people already developed these various non-communicable diseases. One of the most common reason for this non-communicable disease is the physical inactivity. According to the global burden of disease statistics, physical inactivity is the third leading cause for all these non-communicable diseases. So therefore, the lack of activity destroys the good condition of every human being, while movement and methodical exercise save it and preserve it. And as I mentioned, the inactivity and the chronic disease is a global pandemic now, especially in the last 8 or 9 months after the COVID-19 pandemic across the globe, because of the social distancing, because of a social restrictions in the social participation, further there is an increase in the physical inactivity and the sedentary behavior. And thereby, there is a risk for developing these type of conditions very high. And physical inactivity, if you look at in the disease process, also whatever the prevalence we are telling is it's called the iceberg phenomena. It is not the 100% only. We can able to see the one, not even 1/3 of the thing is visible. The 2/3 is not visible. Therefore, if you look at across the community, these complications or these comorbidities or this health burden may be a much, much higher. But what the statistics, what we are telling is only a sample representation of our population. And if you look at the known disease, as I mentioned, it is only a very, very, the 1/3 of the thing we are addressing. And we have not addressed the entire risk factors. Among all these risk factors, whatever you call, the lifestyle is one of the most common reason for all these complications or the problem. Lifestyle problems. When we say the lifestyle problem is the lack of physical activity or exercise, an improper diet habit, and then the stress. These three are actually the killing not only the older population, even the younger generation. Therefore, we as a physiotherapist, as I mentioned earlier, we have an important role in the prevention as an exercise or the physical activity. It is our responsibility to create awareness among the people. Another important thing, health burden of inactivity versus smoking. It is most of the time we ask in the history, when you take the history of a people, we always ask about, do you have a smoking history? But routinely in the clinical practice, we are not asking about their physical activity level or their sedentary behavior. If you look at, a sedentary behavior is as highly having a risk factor like a smoking. Suppose if an individual become inactive for a day, it's an equivalent to a 3 cigarette smoking. If a person is inactive for a whole week, it can equal to a smoking a pack of cigarette. So do we ask these questions in the clinical practice? Normally we ask, do you have a smoking history or other histories? But we sedentary behavior, physical inactivity is not addressed adequately in the clinical practice. It's important for us to understand because these terminologies are commonly we interchange and use, even though it has a different meaning. When you say the physical activity, all of us know it is not structured. It's an unstructured. When you say unstructured, it helps only in increasing the energy expenditure. Therefore, any bodily movement with the contractions of the skeletal muscle, there is a substantial increase in the resting energy expenditure. Or compared to the resting energy expenditure, there is an increase in the expenditure of the energy. And the most important thing is that needs to be a minimum of 10 minutes. So 10 minutes of physical activity is one component of the aspect. The second important thing is the exercise. When you say the exercise, it's a form of physical activity, or we usually call it as it's a component of the physical activity, but it is structured, it is planned, it involves the repetitive movement of the bodily structure, and we focus on any one of the component of the physical fitness. When you say that any one of the component of the physical fitness, normally we have a 3-5 important component in the any physical fitness. The first one is called the flexibility, the second one is called the body composition, third one is called the muscle strength, fourth one is called the endurance, and then the fifth one is called the aerobic capacity, functional capacity or the aerobic capacity. So we need to decide which component needs to be addressed according to the individual need. Whenever you go for an exercise prescription, exercise testing is first. Before you perform the testing, you also need to decide which component needs to be addressed. So this, and further, once again, the physical fitness is related to the health or related to the skill. Most of the time, we focus mainly on the health related. As I mentioned, it's a cardiovascular endurance, body composition, muscular strength and endurance, as well as the flexibility. The next important component is the physical activity. The physical activity is actually, if you look at the domains are differ from the exercise component. There are 4 important domains in the physical activity. The first one is called the domestic. The second one is called the work. The third one is called the transportation. The fourth one is called the leisure time physical activity. So it is important for us to screen both these components, both the physical activity component as well as the exercise component during the initial evaluation of the participants. It is also important to know what component needs to be addressed. When you are performing an exercise test or when you are performing a physical activity assessment, what component needs to be addressed? The first important thing is normally we measure the maximum oxygen consumption or the oxygen consumption reserve or heart rate reserve or maximum heart rate or the metabolic equivalent. These are all the various method or the technique by which we assess the intensity, and this is actually an important parameter to understand the exercise capacity of an individual, and it also gives a direction for us to prescribe the exercise in the later stage. And according to your exercise testing, you can stratify them as low, moderate or high based on the MET. Before you go for any of the exercise evaluation, a screening is must. Normally, there are 2 important screening tools in the clinical practice routinely we use. All of us know or familiar with the physical activity readiness questionnaire plus. It's called PARQ plus 2020. It's a new version is available. Basically, there are 7 questionnaires which if anyone says yes to any one of the thing, they need to go for further medical evaluation and then only you consider them for the exercise, further exercise evaluation and the exercise prescription. The second component is usually it helps in stratifying them, whether they are low, moderate or the high risk. This is important when you are screening a healthy individual or when you go for a community screening. You don't know whether they have any already known comorbidities or the health condition. In those cases, it based on their positive risk factors, based on their signs and symptoms, we can able to stratify them as low, moderate or the high risk individual. And this will give us the direction for the selection of the exercise testing as well as the selection of the intensity prescriptions during the phase of exercise prescriptions or the rehabilitation. This point I have already mentioned. There are multiple positive risk factors for the AHA, ACSM risk stratification questionnaire: family history, cigarette smoking, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, impaired glucose, obesity, and the sedentary lifestyle. And also, they can manifest any of the pain or the signs and symptoms which related to the cardiovascular or the pulmonary condition. So these are all the major signs: ankle edema, palpitations or the claudications or the murmur. Accordingly, we can stratify low, moderate or the high risk. Actually, the low risk younger individuals, asymptomatic, and moderate, men more than 45, female more than 55. High risk, if already diagnosed the case of any one of the condition, irrespective of the signs and symptoms they report, they comes under the high risk. This gives us the direction for further evaluation, how exactly we need to proceed. Suppose if the low risk, for prescriptions of the moderate exercise, you no need to go for any of the further evaluation. Whereas if they are moderate or the high risk, for the moderate risk, before we go for high intensity exercise, exercise testing needs to be done, and then accordingly you can prescribe. Whereas high risk, it is recommended for all moderate to high intensity exercise prescription, the further exercise testing is required. This is one component of the assessment. The second important thing is, you may be seeing your conditions with the elderly people having a lot of comorbidities, more of neurodegenerative disorders, you feel this exercise testing may not be advisable to them. In those cases, the alternative approach is we can go for the physical activity measurement. Physical activity measurement is basically it has a specific purpose. Which aspects are important? You can also observe the changes, evaluate the intervention, and also determine the physical inactivity prevalence and then the predict with the accuracy. So there are various methods by which we can measure the physical activity assessment, starting from the self-reported questionnaire to the direct calorimetry. So the direct or the indirect calorimetry can be used both for the exercise testing also. This, when we say the physical activity, our purpose is to assess the energy expenditure. Therefore, any of these methods can be used to assess the energy expenditure of an individual. So what we need to do is, it is what is relevant to us needs to be selected, because there are variety of questions are available in the clinical system or the clinical practice. What is available, needed, what is more accurate, what is culturally acceptable to our population, that we need to select. Because physical activity has a strong socio-cultural component that is very, very important when you are selecting the questionnaire. So when you measure the physical activity, your focus will be on the two important aspects. One is aspect to measure. The second one is techniques to measure. When you say the aspect, you can measure the frequency, duration, intensity, and the type. Then the techniques are criterion, objective, or the subjective measure. In most of the time in the clinical practice, it is not possible for us to go for an objective measures always. Therefore, the subjective questionnaires can be used to screen the physical activity level of an individual. Sometimes one possible limitations of the physical activity questionnaire is it can extrapolate. There is a 10% of always reporting of higher energy expenditure when you use the subjective questionnaire as compared to the objective measures, therefore these component can be taken into consideration when we go for the physical activity promotion aspect. As I said, there are various types of questionnaires are available. Normally the time frame of recall is important. Most of the time, if it is last one day, it may not be very, very appropriate because it is too short for us to get the physical activity profile of an individual. If you look at past 1 month or past year, it may be recall will be a difficult task. Patient may not able to recall last 1 month what they did. Therefore, in the clinical practice, the last 1 week recall is ideally accepted. And it also helps in providing the information about the leisure time, occupational, or the transportation activities separately. There are various activity questionnaires are available. One is called the International Physical Activity Questionnaire Long Form, International Physical Activity Questionnaire Short Form. I will not go into the details of this. Then the last one is, this is more appropriate for us, developed by the World Health Organization, Global Physical Activity Questionnaire. This is has a strong, one is the domain. The second important thing is the cross-cultural adaptation is good. Then the most important thing is you can able to quantify the MET for each type of activity, because it gives the information. Somebody says, I do the activity in a sitting. Somebody says, I do the activity in a standing. Somebody says, I have a vigorous activity with the like walking or other activity. According to that, you can stratify them as low, moderate, and high. And accordingly, the energy spent or the energy expenditure required for each activity can be referred. And accordingly, we can able to calculate the total activity per week or the METs per week. PETs, you normally we call it as METs minute per week. What is an activity profile of an individual? And another important point here is the WHO compendium is available. We can edit, it is easily available in the World Health Organization site also. There are more than 236 activities have been listed, and each activity's MET is provided so that we can refer easily, and then what is an overall MET minute per week of an individual can be calculated. This is one important aspect. The second important aspect, as I said, you can stratify them as a low, moderate, or the high. How much is the low intensity activity they do? How much is the moderate, and how much is the high intensity activity they do? So this is an advantage of the Global Physical Activity Questionnaire. There are many questionnaires, as I said, I will not go into the details of that. Next important thing is also need to know the sedentary behavior questionnaire. Sometimes the people says, I walk for a 30 minute in a day. Normally we say 30 minutes into 5 days, 150 minutes per week. And if you say it is a brisk walking, then almost about 4 METs per minute. Then we say 600 METs per minute per week is the his activity profile. Anything above 600, we call individual as a healthy. Anything less than 600, we call it as a low on the sedentary. Anyone less than 600 to 300, we call it as a low physical activity profile. Anything less than 300, we call them as a sedentary. So, and whenever you measure the physical activity profile, it's also need to know the sedentary behavior, because normally in the GPAC, if you look at last 2 days of a week, you can able to get the sedentary behavior nature of an individual also. But in addition to that, it is important that we need to know what is the sedentary behavior nature of an individual, because this is important, because when we do the physical activity promotion, first our objective is to break the sedentary nature. If you say walk for a 30 minutes and then remaining 8 or 9 hours, most of the time we also follow that. We sit continuously and then do the activity. So your 30 minutes may not be adequate enough to maintain your metabolic need. So that there needs to be some amount of physical activity behavior needs to be corrected. Then maybe in between the working, we may have to facilitate them to go for a shorter form of physical activity, or any other strategies can be used. Thereby, you break the continuous sedentary nature of an individual. This is very, very important, because Even if you prescribe 30 minutes activity, sometimes people say, I'm not able to get any physiological benefit, either weight loss or I'm not able to get any benefit. The reason is their sedentary nature is more than the physical activity or the exercise nature. So that we need to balance these two, then only we get a desirable benefit. There are various objective measures. I will not go into the details of this. The most important message here is, ideally, according to the cohort studies published in by the ACSM, what it is highlighting is, ideally, we need to have a minimum of 10,000 steps per day. That is an ideal recommended level of activity we need to do to keep ourselves healthy or free from any of the lifestyle diseases. So accordingly, we can stratify anyone in the less than 5,000 steps per day sedentary, 5,000 to 7,499 is low active, 7,500 to 9,999 is somewhat active, anyone more than 10,000 steps is active, more than 12,500 steps per day is considered to be highly active. So this will help us to understand the physical activity profile of an individual. One common method we use, pedometer or the accelerometer. I'm just highlighting only the accelerometer here. Otherwise, in the pedometer also, it can be used in your routine clinical practice. The advantage of accelerometer is it provides you the steps, minutes of the light, moderate, and the vigorous physical activity. Whereas in the pedometer, you get the number of steps you have taken, kilocalorie consumed, and other parameter it gives. But it is not stratifying you as what is your activity nature, either low, moderate, or the vigorous. So normally what we do is, when we screen them for the physical activity questionnaire, when the patient comes to us, and then what we do is, 1 week, we will give them the accelerometer to wear at home, and continuously, except the sleeping hours, we tell them that try to wear that. Even though the adherence is not very good, but 20 to 22% is only adherence. Remaining, they may not use it as per our advice. Even it is okay to get some good information. This percentage is ideally enough in the beginning to do our to understand the physical activity profile of our participant or the community. So after 1 week, we call them back. At that time also, we take once again the physical activity questionnaire and we record what is the activity recorded with the accelerometer. So this is one simple method we can compare what the patient reporting to you, what the actually or the objectively measured data, whether it is matching. So this is the way we can quantify the exercise volume or the dose. So this is a simple method, like based on these two, how exactly quantifying the exercise volume or the dose. I'm just giving a one simple calculation here. Somebody says 4 sessions per week, 30 minutes workout per day, your intensity will be 8 kilocalorie per hour if an individual of body weight of 60. So then when the level one, you can able to calculate what is the total hours they spent per week. The second one is total energy expended or the spent per week. And based on this, 5 days a week, based on the body weight, what is the energy spent per a person in a week? Is it enough? I will come to that little later. So this information is a preliminary data for us to provide a direction for your appropriate exercise prescription based on the patient need and based on your expert opinion. Somebody may need to go for a weight loss. What is your strategy? Somebody may just to go for a maintenance program. What is our strategy? Somebody is focusing mainly on managing the comorbidities. Examples like diabetes, cardiovascular disease, or hypertension. What is our strategy? Accordingly, then we need to prescribe. In addition to this, it is another important thing, new approach. It is important for us to measure their energy expenditure. There are various methods by which we can able to measure the energy expenditure. Resting metabolic rate, basal metabolic rate, and the thermal effect of exercise. So why this is important is, when you say the metabolism has a three important component. the daily activity, exercise, and the thermal effects of our meal. So these all the other confounding factors for a good weight management of an individual. If you look at in any individual, whether we do the activity or not, what happens is our up to 60% of our energy goes for our basal metabolism. This is basically to protect all our vital structure. The 10% goes for our thermic effect of food for the digestion. The type of and the frequency, the amount of food we have taken, accordingly, the thermic effect of the food can increase or decrease. Normally, the remaining percent needs to go for our activity. Whereas, this is the component where we are now compromising. This is the one thing is reduced drastically. Therefore, most of the time, the people are prone for developing various lifestyle disorders. So our objective is to enhance or facilitate on this. So why this is important is energy intake should be equal to the energy expenditure. Then we will have a good balanced body weight and other aspect. So one method is you can resting metabolic rate. There are various methods, objective measures or the test is available. I'm talking only about the clinical component, which can be used in most of the clinical practice. The one is the resting metabolic rate is the total daily metabolic activity. Normal range is 1,800 to 3,000 kilocalorie per day. It can vary from individuals to individual. And in a healthy or the general population, it goes with 1,200 to 2,400 kilocalorie. Varies in gender like male and the female also. So one simple formula we can calculate is 1 kilocalorie into body weight into 24 hours. You can able to easily calculate the resting metabolic rate of an individual, whether it is high or low. This is the very simple method. If your basal metabolic rate or your resting metabolic rate is low, this is the one of the common reason for the not patient is not able to gain the weight loss. Examples like thyroid or any other thing, usually they have an altered basal or the resting metabolic rate. So whereas the basal metabolic rate is usually rate at which a person body burns energy in the form of calorie while at rest. It can play an important role in the weight gain. So how we can usually we can calculate is basically male it is 1600 to 1800 kilocalorie per day. Female it is 1200 to 1450 kilocalorie per day. This is the formula we can use. You no need to do any exercise test. You need to go for any other objective measures to calculate. This is reasonably a validated formula. 10 into weight in kg plus 6.25 into height in centimeter, then age plus 5. The same way we can calculate for the female population. Next important assessment is when you don't have any facility for submaximal exercise testing, a simple method or test is to perform their functional capacity. Most of the time, we can rely on this and then based on that, we can start the initial prescription because this is acceptable even patients with osteoarthritis and so many other comorbidities. All of us know the procedure. I will not go into the details of this. So basically, what is the distance covered in a 6 minutes, which reflects the functional capacity of an individual? Ideally, it should be 5 minutes and above. Then safely, you can go for the 40 to 55% of the intensity can be prescribed in this, even in a diseased population, comfortably, if they achieve 5 minutes and above with your functional capacity assessment. These are the formulas all of us know. I will not go into the details of this. Why this is important is, based on all this, you calculate what is an energy expenditure of an individual. Normally, as I said, energy expenditure of our goal should be 150 to 400 kilocalorie per day. Suppose if you perform 150 kilocalorie per day for a 5 or 6 days, your objective will be 1000 kilocalorie per week. Therefore, this is the minimum threshold required as a maintenance program. And this is also an initial goal of prescription for sedentary population. Suppose if an individual is having already a diagnosed cardiovascular, metabolic, pulmonary, or other disorders, ideally our recommendation should be 1200 to 1600 kilocalorie per week. And our focus, if it is on weight management, then ideally our focus should be minimum of 2000 kilocalorie per week. So accordingly, you have to provide an education to the patient, explain them. And most of the time, patient comes to us that by 1 week, 2 week, they want to lose the weight. It is not possible and it is not practical. Anybody loses the weight early, it is not the fat, it is actually the body fluid or the body protein. So our focus of weight management is basically a fat loss. When we say the weight loss, it should be a fat loss. This explanation and sensitization needs to be provided to the patient. So I will not go into the prescriptions according to the condition, but what the recommended guidelines says. According to the Center for Disease Control or the American College of Sports Medicine, minimum of more than 30 minutes of moderate activity 5 days per week is the general recommendation. More than 20 minutes of vigorous activity, minimum of 3 days per week, or simple recommendation is 30 minutes of activity 5 days per week. And exercise is medicine. How much should our patient take? According to the guidelines or the customized thing, this healthy people 2010 guidelines says more than 30 minutes of moderate activity or more than 20 minutes of vigorous activity, 3 sessions per week. So there are aerobic capacity or the strengthening component also needs to be introduced. If it is aerobic physical activity component, moderate of 150 minutes per week, vigorous of 75 minutes per week, or minimum of 10 minutes at least, preferably spread throughout the week. In a recovering patient, phase 1 completed cardiac rehab patients, or any deconditioned patient, initially start with 10 minutes, maybe 1 session a day, then 2 session a day, then gradually progress. And also, it is important that aerobic and the strength component needs to be integrated together. So that we need to focus on strengthening of the major group of muscles, and at least 8 to 10 exercise, 8 to 12 repetitions of one set needs to be done. At least minimum of 2 sessions per week needs to be incorporated as a resistance training in our prescription. There is some modifications in the aged more than 65 years. Strength should be repetitions with the low intensity training, because we need to focus on improving their endurance rather than the strength component. And most importantly, incorporate the balance exercise component in this elderly population. So what is our responsibility? What we need to do? Include exercise in all treatment plan. Every patient, every visit, every treatment plan, like how we are measuring their body mass index, how we are measuring their other vital signs, exercise or physical activity screening needs to be and one of the important vital sign component in our clinical practice. And in case if the patient is not able to adhere to the prescription, at least a 30 minutes of moderate, 5 sessions a week needs to be an initial recommendation, then gradually we should do. We must begin to merge the fitness industry with the healthcare industry. Most of the time in advertisement and all, we see people promote the equipment, but at the end, people, patients or the people, they use for this purpose. It is not used for the as a, so it is important that whatever the mode of exercise they want to do, that needs to be prescribed by the physiotherapist, and industry may promote, but treadmill, people will suddenly buy the treadmill, but after 1 week they develop knee pain, so other complication, then it will be used for some other purpose. So we need to take the lead in merging the fitness industry in our healthcare industry, so that we will be providing, we will be recommending what tool the patient needs to use according to the individual need. Physical, as I said, physical inactivity is a major public health problem of our time. All of us are the clinicians have a major responsibility to assess physical activity habit, inform patients of risk and prescribe proper exercise. Where time allows, consider formal exercise treatment or referral. Exercise is medicine that we need to take and get patients to take. If we according to the American College of Sports Medicine, if we had a pill that conferred all the benefits of exercise, clinician would prescribe it to every patient. Our healthcare system would find a way to make sure that every patient had access to this wonderful drug. Therefore, exercise is medicine. And the last important message is breaking down the barriers. Initially, if you say 30 minutes, 40 minutes, nobody will adhere to that. First, we need to change the behavior. Make exercise a habit, not an option. 30 minutes per week is a goal, not starting point. So start small. 1 to 2 days per week, 10 minutes bout. Simple recipe for getting your exercise, lunch, walk 5 minutes, out, eat, or wherever is possible. Instead of using the vehicle and other thing, gradually we can say that you try to be more mobile, more active. Thereby, we are trying to break their physical inactivity or the sedentary behavior. So I'm going to prescribe something that works like surgery and drugs, but cost much less than the surgical or the other aspect. That is exercise as treatment or exercise as the medicine. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Maya, for the informative session. I now request the panelists to kindly begin with the question and answer session.
Thank you, Dr. Maya, for enlightening exercise as a medicine or exercise prescription, the dosage, which is very important. So I have only one question, that when we say the dosage, it should be in a proper fit formula, what we say, frequency, intensity, time and time. But there are some people who overtake their exercise, who overtake their medicine. What do you have to say for that? Overdosage.
Madam, actually overdose either in medicine or in exercise, it's not a good practice. Because exercise, if it is not properly performed, like including a warm-up, a good flexibility, incorporating the breathing with the warm-up aspect, then if they go for aerobic and then the cool-down, then exercise have a very good physiological benefit. If they do the over exercise, that will have an impact on the musculoskeletal health. Therefore, ideally, it is not good to do the over-exercising. And that can cause more injury rather than the physiological benefit. The second important thing is exercise and inflammatory mediator, especially in the COVID era, we are discussing that.
Yes.
Exercise also needs to be gradually progressed. If somebody starts the high intensity on the day one, it may be having a negative impact rather than the physiological benefit, because these markers will not get adapted or they will not become an immunomodulator with the high intensity training. They become more immunosuppressor. So that will have an harm to the patient rather than the benefit. Therefore, that needs to be prescribed with the low to moderate, and then according to the re-evaluation, then we need to progress.
Thank you. Jaimala Madam.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Maya, for the great information that you have given in a very short time. I would like to point out here that after we brought in ICIDH2 in our syllabus, all the students have been putting it as an impairment at the end of every case, whether it is a hemiplegia, whether it is radical mastectomy, they will always write the last impairment as reduced functional capacity. And I feel very happy about it, that for each and every patient, whatever disease, students are marking it as an impairment, because age is going to have its effect. Now, for example, a paraplegic also, we never emphasize that they are going to age and they have to do aerobic capacity. So, you know, we are doing a great job. But as ACSM says, every profession has to prescribe exercise, say that exercise is needed. And I would like, sir, to ask about side effects of exercise. We talked about overdose. Side effects are very good, I feel.
Yeah, side effect of exercise, if it is not prescribed as per the individual need, the one important thing may be it can put an immediate impact on the cardiac system. Therefore, the oxygenations to the other systems gets compromised. The patient may get syncope or an early fatigue. And second thing is, if the flexibility component is not introduced in the beginning of the exercise, exercise side effects may be related to the injury to the musculoskeletal system. Okay. Other than that, exercise may not have any direct side effect if it is prescribed properly.
Yeah. I wanted to ask one more question, that when we are referring to MET values, can we adopt directly the Western MET values, or do we have a compendium?
This is actually a very interesting question, madam. Actually, yeah. Normally we say 1 MET equal to 3.5 ml.
Yeah.
That is based on the body composition of a Western population. Whereas in our center, if you look at one, we've already published a scholar study. He measured with the different age group of our Indian population, especially in the part of our area. What we observed is it is about 2.8 extrapolating. So there may be a larger trial, multi-center trial may be required in Indian populations to establish the MET.
So if it is 3.5 Indians, it is 2.5.
2.8. In female, 2.8. We observe 2.8, 2.8. And male, it is 3. Okay. 3 to 3.1. Mm-hmm. Because the samples was less, therefore we are not able to say that this is the mean or the reference range for our Indian population. But definitely it is, as compared different to the Western population, our MET value is lower.
So we need to know this, that there is a difference, because you know, students keep on asking, and so that's why I raised this question.
Maya wants to go, but I will put one more question and then Rajni. If the person's aim is for the physical fitness, you know, just a health promotion and to improve the physical fitness, would you advise the high intensity exercise or a high intensity training or a continuous exercise, continuous aerobic?
It depends upon what is their objective, madam. Physical fitness. If I talk related to the general population,
yes,
or in the deceased, we should
go with general population for general health promotion.
Yeah, it is actually a moderate to high will be recommended, not directly the high intensity.
Okay, sir. So a continuous type with a moderated intensity.
Different schools of thoughts, intermittent versus the continuous. That, but in some component says you can go for a circuit training will be much better than the a continuous one mode of aerobic training. Ideally, but I say usually 20 minutes of continuous training is a minimum suggestions. Based on our experience, I recommend.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, Rajni ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Maya, for the beautiful lecture. Sir, I have two questions. One is, since our viewers will be students as well as clinicians, and also the academicians. So I just want you to highlight on role of documentation of exercise prescription, because we say a lot about exercise prescription, but when it comes to documentation, people fail to document, so that there is lack of communication between the personnel, the physiotherapists themselves, and also we don't put our concepts across or in front of the doctors also. So what will be the right way of documentation?
Yeah, this is actually a very good question, and it is not just in the exercise. Yes. Maybe if you look at, if you do the survey across our physiotherapy treatment, the documentation we give least importance. We are not addressing. Actually, the documentation is very, very important. Mm-hmm. It's one for referring them to the others. The second one is, it is important for us to know the pre and post changes. The third important thing is, It is also that the systematic way when we evaluate and then we document and then prescribe, even if some physicians or anyone referring, when the patient go back to them and they see how systematically we have evaluated and then the prescribed, that gives a lot of scientific reasoning or the evidence for our practice. Yes. So it is important that in a first evaluation, all of us needs to go for a detailed documentation. We need to important that we need to develop an exercise evaluation and prescription assessment form. It needs to consist of the demography, the body composition, the flexibility composition, the strength component, and then the aerobic fitness or the functional capacity assessment, then the findings of our things, and then the next coming to the prescription component. In the prescription component, we need to mention, I wanted to go for what type of prescription, initially start with the aerobic, when to progress to the resistance. This all needs to be documented in the initial thing. Subsequently, maybe only an important finding can be, as a follow-up, we can record the important finding. Otherwise, in the first evaluation, we need to spend a lot of time with the patient or our client. We need to document it thoroughly.
Okay, thank you, sir. Sir, and one more question, that what is the role of antioxidants? When, for example, when we are giving exercise prescription for aged population, yes. So what is the role of antioxidants in them?
And actually, exercise also have an effect on antioxidant. Basically, they act on the respiratory chain mechanism. Because you say that at the mitochondrial level or the cellular level, whenever we say the cellular level oxygenation, to promote that, these antioxidants have an important role. And exercise, when you say our aerobic component is called the oxidative phase. When you look at the exercise component or the prescriptions, when we say, initially we go with the carbohydrate or the fat, or is all this, we call it as a oxidative phase or the aerobic phase. So exercise also acts like an antioxidant, it promotes the cellular respirations at the mitochondrial level. This all they act like an immunomodulator. Okay. Antioxidant, because even if you look at in the COVID thing, this is important because they fight against these organisms or the infection agents. Okay. If the oxidative metabolism is good or an oxidative capacity of an individual is good, our defense mechanism will be good. So exercise also have an important, as I mentioned in the beginning, immunomodulator, thereby it improves the defense mechanism.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Okay, madam. Then thank you all, madam.
Thank you, sir. Shall I leave then? I have to connect
another meeting at 5:30. Thank you all, madam. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you,
Dr. Thank you so much. Pleasure to have you. Okay, sir.
Thanks a lot. Bye. Bye.
I once again thank Dr. Maya for his informative session on exercise as a medicine. It is always a pleasure to listen to, sir. Our viewers must have definitely gained a lot from this webinar. I also thank our panelists for their valuable inputs. I thank our entire Physio TV team, Dr. Ashok Shyam sir, Mr. Rahul Chaube, Dr. Apoorv Shimpi, Dr. Neeraj Athavale, Dr. Manish Rai, Dr. Amruta Poddar, and all other members of Physio TV. Lastly, a big thank you to all our viewers who have been vital in making this webinar successful. Looking forward for your support in upcoming webinars as well. This is Dr. Rucha Raya signing off for the day. Thank you once again. Stay safe and have a good day.